Okay, thanks very much. The recent crash really shows you the very narrow line which we're on between life and death. Fortunately, I'm on the life side, so that's okay. Just as an after discharge from the last session, being a neurologist, you always talk about after discharges. The most amazing thing in terms of brain science is the work done with blind people. And that is that their visual cortex takes over sensation in the hand in some, and their auditory cortex takes over spatial representation in others. So it means everything I've been taught about my neurology is wrong. The visual cortex in people who have seen with the cortex isn't the visual cortex. It will in fact support finger sensation. So we've got our neurology totally wrong. Okay, well that's a start. What I'd like to do today is to talk about near-death experiences and approaching death experiences. And the reason for that is that I became interested in the near-death experience when I had a patient who had it. And what I needed to do was to try and understand them if I could. And then it seems to me that the models which we have are really not good enough. Our materialistic models aren't, because they always end at the brain. And what was quite clearly happening was that this was not ending at the brain. So I thought that what I needed to do is to look further into other models which we could elide, if you like, with the standard mechanical model. So for today, we'll set out the problems. I'm going to look at cardiac arrest NDEs, end-of-life experience, and I'll occasionally drop the word ELE, and that's end-of-life experience, contribution of these to models of our understanding of consciousness, and some sort of conclusion, I hope. And for this talk, mind equals consciousness, because I'm not going to get into that debate. So that's the position I'm coming from. Okay, the problem. Really can be stated quite simply, the standard paradigm states that brain processes and only brain processes are responsible for the generation experience of consciousness. We all know that. The transmission theory, our constructs of the world are in part the transmission of the absolute nature of reality, whatever that is, and part brain processes. And as you all know, William James was one of the people, but of course there are numbers of others who mentioned it both before and it's been elaborated since then. So basically the transmission theory. So those are the two sides that I'm going to look at. Now, if you're going to ask the question, what is the relationship between brain and mind, then I have worked the whole time with CAT scans, fMRIs, magnetoencephalography, EEG, and there's no consciousness there. There are magnetic fields, there are electrical fields, there is the transmission of information, but there's no consciousness, so that's not going to help me. So I think you've got to look for outliers, and are there situations where mind and brain are not the same? Because if they aren't, you'll only just get what you look for. Yes, when there is no brain function, but experiences reported, e.g. cardiac arrest NDEs, and these thus represent non-brain experience, and I'll support that later. And are there any other outliers? Yes. Are there situations when consciousness starts to loosen from the brain and finally separates and disintegrates? Well, yes, during the process of death. So subjective experiences of the dying should show similarities to that of the NDE. So if there is a transcendent reality, we'll see it in the NDE, and we'll pick it up as people slowly attenuate their normal structures of consciousness. Well, that's the theory. So let's look at near-death experiences. Now, these are very familiar to you all, so I'm not going to go into it. This is just a summary of NDE papers by Rousseau, and it's a nice summary. And overall incidence about 4%. What I want to draw your attention to is this. Awareness of being dead is one, and out-of-body experiences is another. You see, this, they colour up nicely. And bright light, I want to draw your attention to, that's 72%. And the other ones are... Okay, the being of light, I want to light up. Knowledge and wisdom and love. And then the other realms are enormously important. So, being of light and light and the other realms or the fantastic gardens, etc., in our culture, not in others, of the near-death experience. And this one is terribly important. You can't actually see it, but I can read it to you. And that is dead relatives and friends and spiritual beings who appear in 41% of NDEs. So these are the things that I want to stress. So let's look at cardiac arrest NDEs. When we got over 2,000 letters from our first film on NDEs, and what became quite apparent to me was that if you want to ask serious questions about the NDE in terms of its own provenance, what generates it, you can't use an ordinary NDE because you don't know what the brain state is. There's one thing where you do know the brain state, and that is during cardiac arrest NDEs, if they occur during the cardiac arrest. Well, the incidents during cardiac arrests varies from about 10 to 20%. There are numbers of studies on this. But the main thing that I want to say is that the phenomena of the arrest NDEs are the same as the phenomena of the non-arrest NDEs, which is interesting. So I now can argue from the arrest NDEs to the non-arrest NDEs. And also that the depth of them varies according to the closeness to death. So that has something to do with it. The outer body is veridical. This is evidence for the non-local functioning of mind during a cardiac arrest. The outer body experience is veridical. Remote viewing, bright light, which is transcendental, experience of other realms, and dead relatives, friends, and spiritual beings. So keep those categories in mind. Out of body, remote viewing, bright light, experience of other realms, and transcendence. And this is the standard thing that you walking along, your heart stops, your consciousness goes down, it restarts, and you have a confusional arousal. And I've done it right. The NDE is thought to occur at that time. When I say thought to occur, there's a lot of discussion of this, but I think I'm fairly happy that it actually does occur then. Because if it occurs, you won't get it going down because it's too quick, and you won't get it when you arouse because it's confusional, and they're very clear. So they probably occur then. A little bit of neurology for you. When the heart stops, the brain stem goes down, so you have no heartbeat controlled from the brain stem, no respiration controlled from the brain stem, and you have no consciousness also controlled from the brain stem. So in fact, the brain is dead. Now, people who don't really understand brain function will say, oh, there's just a little bit of brain functioning. Rubbish. A, there isn't, and B, if there is, it's not going to support consciousness, and it's not going to support clear consciousness of the sort that occurs in the NDE. Because you see, there has to be the whole of this sort of mechanism, which is initiated from the brain stem, which keeps the cortex working. And it's not there, because the brain stem is down. So cardiac arrest and electrical silence indicate that the brain stem and cortex are inactive. So you can't go along any of those lines. So then, what is the evidence that during that phase, you can in fact experience things? There are over 100 anecdotal veridical OBE cases, and those are during cardiac arrest. And the subject leaves his body and sees the resuscitation, usually from above. And if any of you want that, it's chapter 9 of Jan Holden's book, published in 2009. So there are more cases now. So if you're going to test the veridical nature of the NDE, you want a cardiac arrest and an OBE group, an out-of-body experience group. You could use as a control for that cardiac arrests and no out-of-body experiences, because people are going to say, if you ask them after the arrest what happened during it, we've all seen television programs and so on, so everybody says, well, of course they know. Well, in fact, Penny Sartori, who did her PhD on NDEs, divided them up into those who said they could see what was happening and those who said they couldn't, and then looked at their accounts, and the accounts of the people who said they could see what was happening were much more accurate than those who couldn't. So it's just another piece of information. Okay, now I want to show you this one. You probably don't know it. How many of you do Sam Parnia's book and the NDE in it? And it's this particular one. Well, most of you don't, some of you do. Okay, so what we're dealing with is a 50-year-old man not feeling well, going to hospital. They see that he's got cardiac problems, take him up to the cardiac cath lab. So this guy's in the cath lab. And he goes into ventricular fibrillation. That's VF there. With the ventricular fibrillation, his heart obviously is stopped. He's unconscious, so he's unconscious on the table. Everybody sees it. The next thing that happens is he says he leaves his body, okay. They put on something which is called an AED, that's automatic external defibrillator. And this has a protocol with it. So you put the electrodes on and it measures the heart and sees whether it's in normal rhythm or not. If it's not in normal rhythm, it will advise a shock. So that's what happened. And it says it out aloud, advise shock. So they give him a shock and there's no response. In other words, he remains in ventricular fibrillation, deeply unconscious, and they have to do a full round of CPR. In other words, they have to pummel his chest, etc. That goes on for 3 or 4 minutes. This guy's unconscious there. And then they put it on again, and the machine says, advise shock. So he's still in ventricular fibrillation throughout this time. And then his heart starts. So we've got a clear period of unconsciousness, no cardiac output, it's absolutely solid, and he's unconscious. There's no little bit of consciousness there, the guy is out. And we know that he's unconscious from 3 to 5 minutes. But he was aware during this time. He saw himself leave his body at the beginning, went up, actually should be there, into a corner of the room, looked back. In fact, it was slightly different from that. There was a woman he saw, who he then later classified as an angel, who said to him when he was lying on the bed, come up, come up. And he thought, don't be ridiculous, how am I going to get up there? Next thing he knew, he was up there. So thought transfer, really. This level of consciousness. And then he looked back and he heard both that and that, saw the resuscitation process. So he has clear consciousness during the time of his arrest, which is monitored. I mean, it's about the best case you can get. What I'd like to have done is to have had EEG electrodes on or oxygen monitoring of the brain. But in essence, you don't really need that because the guy's out, he's unconscious, he's got no consciousness. So it's a really nice solid case. This case suggests that he was dead to the medical team, but the patient claims to be conscious. So brain and mind are separated during ventricular fibrillation. So that's really quite a powerful statement to be able to make. So, okay, so we can talk about now happily that the brain and mind are separated during the NDE. So what about the mental states, the dying? Can we gain information as the brain fails? I got this nice quote from Stafford Bethe because it is really good in terms of just setting the feelings for it. Whether dying persons are telling us of glimpses of the next world or conversing with people we can't see, we should consider ourselves immensely blessed when it happens. If we don't make the mistake of assuming they're confused, we're likely to feel some of the excitement they convey, for we're witnessing the momentary merging of two worlds that at all other times remain tightly compartmentalized and mutually inaccessible. The merging is what I mean by the spirituality of death. So I want you to get this feeling of two worlds slowly starting to merge as the dying process continues. So let's look at the death process. What is it? How does it occur? And there are lessons for you guys here. All of you must die conscious. So we're going to look at the dissolution of consciousness. And I'm not going to go into this, just to show that we have done a lot of work on this, retrospective studies, prospective studies. We've done it in England and in Holland. We've got over 1,500 emails of stories. And so we've interviewed doctors, nurses, auxiliary staff, chaplains, volunteers, etc., etc. So we've built up a lot of information about the dying process. We gave everybody a questionnaire, looking at deathbed visions, deathbed coincidence, light surrounding the body, shape seen leaving the body, transiting to new reality, and so on. So that's our database, and these are the conclusions, really. So first of all, when we went into this was 2006, it wasn't clear that end-of-life experiences really occurred. No, it was earlier than that. It was about 2000, our paper was in 2006, it was about 2004. And we couldn't say that they actually occurred because there wasn't a consensus in the literature. So we started from the grounds then that they may not occur, and if they did occur, what were they like, or are they just simply fantasies of the dying? Now, in 2014, the present consensus is that over 50% of those dying consciously will have end-of-life experiences. So please, all of you, die consciously. Then you get the fireworks. And if you see somebody coming up to you with a syringe full of midazolam saying, have this, because you're obviously in distress, say, no, I want to watch this whole process. And that's very important, otherwise you won't get some of the things we're talking about. So this is the formulation of the dying process. End-of-life experiences may start with premonitions of own death or another's death. The results of our studies the reason I say that is from the results of our studies and the emails which are sent in. So premonitions are right at the beginning there. The Dalai Lama says 2 years before you may get information about death. I assume that's correct. It's in his book. And if you look at the stories, they're not usually that long. And the stories sometimes relate to premonitory visits by dead relatives. So dead relatives come. I want you just to think about this. My mother was in hospital after a fall and had fractured her ribs. One day she saw my dead brother at the door of her room. She said it made her very happy to see him. How many of you, seeing your dead brother in the doorway of the room, would be very happy to see them? Not many. So it's really interesting. There's a change in consciousness. These things have a different meaning to the person who receives the vision, to the interpretation we put on it and the metric that we're in now. I joked that he had come to take her onto the next world, and we laughed about it. And 2 weeks later, she died unexpectedly. So there's a premonitory visit. This one is a very sad one. It's the mother learns about the fact that her child is going to die. My third daughter, Roberta, was just 7 years old on May the 17th, 1989, when I woke up in the morning totally upset and in mourning over her death. I was so surprised and confused to see her lying next to me that I actually gently nudged her to see if she was alive. So this was a really powerful experience. I don't say dream because she denies she had a dream. I was so she apparently had gotten up during the night and climbed in next to me. When she moved, I cried uncontrollably with relief that she was not dead and hugged her. She did not seem to mind or make any fuss. Perhaps she knew why I felt relief. I did not tell her I had thought she was dead. I could not remember any dream, so it's not a dream. But the feelings were so strong and real, exactly as they were 2 days later when she was the victim of a hit and run accident. So very clear premonition of what was going to occur. So this can be the start of the dead process. I say can be because not everybody has it. The next stage are deathbed visions. This is some of our data, really just to show you how common these are. It's in the retrospective studies between 60 and 70%, in the prospective studies, which are the two end ones, it's about 60% approximately. So they're common, much commoner than people are prepared to say. In fact, there's a split. The medical people say it doesn't happen. The nurses say it does. The nurses are with the patients. They hear the stories. So who do the dying see? Now, keep in mind that we're thinking about near-death experiences at the same time. You can see that parents are the most common. Persons unknown are the next ones, generally defined as spiritual beings, 17%. A lot of people can't speak at that point, but you can greet somebody joyfully. Spouses and siblings, about the same. In our sample, we see very few angels. Pity, I'd have liked an angel. Well, maybe I'll get an angel, I don't know. Sometimes you only see friends, and we only have two examples of dogs and cats. I'm really sorry about the dog and cat lovers. It's mainly going to be humans who come to see you. So, compared to NDEs, dead relatives, friends, spiritual beings appear in 41% of those. So they're very similar. Transiting to a new realm, this is the next phase. This is enormously interesting. The work in Zurich on this is really important. They've just brought out a paper which shows that these are people who are dying of cancer in the last fortnight of their life. Over 50%, in fact, transit to the new realm. Well, you know what it's going to be like, don't you? An area very like that, the NDE, beautiful region where they meet other people, spiritual beings there to help them, dead relatives. Some describe it as a waiting place, wide transcendent feelings, and the Swiss study. So we now have a match between the experience of the NDEs, and as consciousness slowly disappears, because it's only in the last few weeks before death, then you go into this other realm, you come back, you go into the other realm, come back again, etc. Sorry, suddenly she seemed to stare intently at the window. She turned to me and said, "Please, Pauline, don't ever be afraid of dying. I've seen a beautiful light and I was going towards it. I wanted to go into that light. It was so peaceful, I really had to fight to come back." Sadly, she died the next morning, close to death. "But I knew she had seen something that day which gave her comfort and peace when she knew she had only hours to live." So again, a very good match between the NDE. And there's the data, the English prospective and the Dutch prospective, running at about 50% of the carers had seen these experiences. The Irish don't like them very much. So compared to the NDE, where it's 38% of people have these experiences. Now, the next thing is then you come up to death itself. Now, death is absolutely fascinating. It's not just a turning off. There are a whole set of phenomena which occur, mainly non-local. The first one is radiant light in the room of the dying. The Dutch one isn't terribly good here, because a lot of these were volunteers and weren't actually sitting with the dying. But if you could see that, it runs at about 20%. So these are the two retrospective ones. That's the prospective English one, which gives a level of about 30%. So this is dying. This is light in the room of the dying. It can be light which is everywhere in the room. It can be specifically things. It can be spiritual globules of light which are seen in the room at that time. And of course, the light with the dying is very like the light, the NDE, deep knowledge, wisdom and love, if you are in it. All that wisdom and love and knowledge can transform the person who's dying, and you talk about transformation and transcendence. Here are a couple of light stories. I took them because they're nice, simple ones. This is a chaplain. Sometimes I've seen a light which is in a corner, like candlelight. It's a golden light. It's not electric light, and it's not one of the hospice lights. It just appears sometimes. It goes when they die. They take their last breath, and as everything settles down, the light goes out. Another one, when her mother was dying, this amazing light appeared in the room. The whole room was filled with this amazing light, and her mother died. So there is this phenomena of light, which is part of dying. Now I want to go on to the other thing which happens at the time of death. It's a time of death, and the evidence points to it all being within a few moments of death, because we've got a lot of accounts with times. And that is deathbed coincidences, and they occur like this. You're in Florida, and you have a son who's in the UK, and you pick up the fact that he's dying, and there's a connection between the two of you. And so what is this connection, and how does it work? Well, it's fascinating. First of all, they're very common. That's 60% of carers had heard stories about it. So in all the emails we got, a large proportion were devoted to deathbed coincidences. From that, we can say a number of things. First of all, they're driven by the person who's dying. They select who it's going to be. How do we know that? Because of the fact that some people, if you have a broken couple, for example, where the man goes off somewhere, and the woman doesn't care that he's gone, but he, in fact, still devoted to his wife, and he dies, he will visit the wife. So it's driven by him. So it's those people with strong emotional attachments. We've got a number of stories of people who said, my son wasn't there, that's why she came to visit me when his mother died. So it's that sort of thing. The deathbed coincidences are fascinating. The form the visit takes depends on the mental state of the person who's receiving the visit. If they're awake, it's a feeling, it's a compulsion that something has happened to this person, you have to go and ring them up, you have to find out what's happened. If they're asleep, it's quite different. It's a narrative dream in which the dying come, and they do two things. They first of all come to say, to be with the person, and then they give them a message. And the message is, I'm okay, don't worry. And quite often the dream ends with them going into the light. So again, similar sorts of things to the NDE. Now this is also a time of huge parapsychological activity. We've talked about the light, we've talked about the visits at a distance, but you get connections with clocks. We've got many clock stopping stories. I mean, in this audience, you all know my grandfather's clock stopped dead, never to go again, when the old man died, written by an American who visited a pub in Yorkshire. But you all know that story. And in fact, I was wondering if it happens on the continent. I think it does, but you call them long case clocks there, not grandfather clocks. And yeah, they do. And here's a nice story, because is it only mechanical clocks? They're the only ones that stop. What about electric clocks? So I got you this story. My father died at 3:15 a.m. At about 8:30 a.m., I went to tell my Uncle Archie, who'd been close to Dad. Note the emotional relationship. There's always an emotional relationship. As Uncle Archie opened the door, it was clear he was distressed. And as I began to tell him, he interrupted me and said he already knew. He said no one had telephoned him. So there's a bit of a deathbed coincidence here too. But told me to look at the clock on the mantelpiece. It was stopped at 3:15. as was indeed his own wristwatch, his bedside clock, and all other clocks in the house. There was even an LED display, I think on the radio, flashing 3:15. It's really good, so electronic clocks stopped too. I was completely taken aback, but Archie seemed comfortable with the phenomenon, was just concerned at losing someone close to him. So we got lots and lots of clock stories. Got also a lot of animal stories, dogs which howl in different places and so on. So what I want you to think of it as is dying is not just a simple turning off. There are all these parapsychological effects which occur at the end of life. And don't forget that we are, in fact, in the transition to this other realm. Okay, so what's the meaning? The carers are very clear, they're all transpersonal. Going up to 80%. So they all see them as transpersonal phenomena. So let's think a little bit about models of mind and matter. We don't have to worry about eliminative physicalism, do we? With Dan Dennett and the Churchlands. I'm not really a great fan of reductive physicalism either, because I don't think it fits the data. Mental events are real, but not beyond physical processes. What about non-reductive physicalism? Mental properties different, mental events physical, of causal powers, all physical, as only physics can be causal. That's a really interesting one and something one can debate about. Dualistic models, well, as everybody's pointed out, the standard Descartesian dualism is a conflation of two different views. Substance dualism, things, mind and body are two different things. Or Heilig dualism, where mind and body are two different kinds of stuffs, psychonic or mental stuff and physical stuff. If I was going for one, I think I'd probably go for the Heilig one. But I just put in Sir John Eccles. I mean, he has to be aired, doesn't he? Because of his dualistic stance. And also, he puts it nicely. I maintain that the human mystery is incredibly demeaned by scientific reductionism with its claims in promissory materialism to account eventually for all the spiritual world in terms of the pattern of neuronal activity. I mean, it clearly has to be wrong. This belief must be classed as a superstition. I rather like that. But this one I take much more seriously. You all know Penfield, the neurosurgeon in Canada who spent his life with electrodes in the brain, taking out various bits of people's brain. And he says, for myself, this is in his book, The Mystery of the Mind. For myself, after a professional lifetime spent in trying to discover how the brain accounts for the mind, it comes as a surprise now to discover, during this final examination of the evidence, that the dualist hypothesis, separation of mind and brain, seems the more reasonable of the two possible explanations. Now, he's coming from a very wide base of cerebral function. Mind comes into action and goes out of action with the highest brain mechanisms. It's true, but the mind has energy. The form of that energy is different from that of neuronal potentials that travel the external pathways. And then he adds, there, I must leave it. Pity. So he argues for mind and brain being separate. You've probably seen this new transmission theory by Lanza. Anybody familiar with it? He says that we carry space and time around with us like turtles with shells, meaning that when the shell comes off space and time, we still exist. So it's a nice concept about the limitation of the body. The theory implies that death of consciousness simply does not exist. It only exists as a thought because people identify themselves with their body. And he is the guy who did a lot of the work on genetics. So he's got a very high scientific profile. So let's summarize everything. So using the death data, how can we conceive the world? What sort of pattern would it have? Well, this is the pattern of the dying process, as I see it. Premonitions, deathbed visions. You can negotiate with your visions. Do remember that. When your aunt comes to tell you, probably your mum actually, comes to tell you that she's going to come back and pick you up, you can say, not this week. You can't say because there's a great party in the hospice. Well, you won't be taking part in it anyway. But you can say because my son is coming. They'll wait for that. And we've got lovely accounts of negotiation with the deathbed visions. It brings hope and joy. And then you come to this new reality. Terminal lucidity, I haven't talked about, although that's fascinating. And then you come to actual death itself, deathbed coincidences, and then all these parapsychological things like clocks, animals, light, bells. And this is a fascinating one. I haven't given you any stories of that. That's shapes seen leaving the body. They're very clear when people see them. They're described as wisp-like or smoke, and sometimes they're more solid. And they come out usually from the top of the head, sometimes from the chest. We've had one or two that have come out of the feet. And with them, there is a presence in the room as the shape is leaving.
Shouldn't we change the picture of the death there to something else?
I rather like that one. It's in our culture. Oh, in fact, Ravi, just behind you.
Much nicer than that.
Then explanations that are required for the alteration of time are shown by the premonitions and the appearance of the dead relatives. So you've got to think about that. Alterations of space and linking together of minds are shown as dead by deathbed coincidences, and causation of physical phenomena at a distance by consciousness. So one has to have a theory which will do that. We are part of a five-dimensional manifold. Why do I like that theory? This is it, but you probably know this. It's the Bernard Carr really likes this. The idea of the brain, spelt differently, of course, which is the four-dimensional world and the fifth dimension behind it, which is the bulk. And he talks about Kaluza-Klein and the fifth dimension. Why am I attracted to that? I'm attracted to it because of the idea of what people report when they're out of their bodies during a cardiac arrest. They can remotely view, so space is contained. They can, in fact, see all round objects. They can see the bottom, they can see the top, etc. So again, it suggests a different form of reality at that time. And so I quite like the idea of a fifth dimension. We've got to have something like that which will explain the data. Five dimensions will explain the phenomena we find in dying. It's very good that. So you can, if you like, take the idea that you lose the limitation of the four dimensions, and the fifth dimension is the one which comes to the fore. Bernard Carr would like to increase his models to higher levels, but I don't understand that. David Lawton, who I do like, he's worked a lot with near-death experiences, argues for a five-dimensional structure for NDEs and argues that death is simply the withdrawal of the 4D part, leaving the 5D intact. So it's an interesting idea again. Or you can have consciousness part of a non-local informational field, no space and no time. And the person who likes that is Stephen Swartz. Played a little with that and published in Neuroquantology. I don't know whether it makes a coherent story or not, but it's a model of non-local consciousness with no space and no time. And the required features for that model is an intention or directed attention, emotional linking, terribly important, transition of consciousness, which you get, and an entrance into a noumenal reality, which you certainly get in that as well. So, let's end. Hey, I'm early. The great inventor Edison, just hours before his death, he emerged from a coma, opened his eyes, looked upwards, and said, "It's very beautiful over there." Now, we've got lots of those stories. We've also got stories in which the dying say, or the people who are next to the dying report that the dying say just before they die, particularly the non-believers of the latter life, "I was quite wrong. It's quite different from what I thought." So we got a lot of those stories. We got a lot of stories too of people who don't know that a relative has died, and the relative comes in the deathbed vision. And they say to them, they behave as you would do to a relative who you don't know has died. "Hi, nice to see you. What are you doing here?" So you got a number of those stories too, which again is sort of goes in with these models which we're putting forward. And finally, you all know this one. Steve Jobs' sister said, "Wow, wow, wow," as he died. And so you should if you're going into that reality. That's exactly what you'll do. It's very positive, very, very affirming. So, with thanks to all my colleagues who took part in the experimental work, and particularly Una McColville, who did the Irish study, otherwise Sue Brain, Hilary Lovelace, and Inika Kodam. So thank you very much. And if any of you have any stories, peterfenwick_@compuserve.com. Don't forget that. I like stories. So we have a huge bank of stories now. Thanks very much.
And we do have 45 minutes.
Okay, yes. Lena first, then David, and then Max.
This is fascinating topic, of course. Two questions I had. One is, could you say a little bit more about the shapes living the body?
Shapes, yes, shapes. I can.
What kind of shapes? Are they different shapes? Are they different colour in terms of
light? Yeah, I can tell you a little bit about that.
And the second question I had is, are there any reports of the experiences of hellish realms?
Yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah, I'll talk about that too. I didn't put it in, and it's a really good question. Both good questions. The shapes, the idea that there would be shapes from the body, I got from the Tibetan book of living and dying, or Tibetan book of the bed. No, it was the Dalai Lama's book, in which he gives the mental states of the dying, and it starts off with seeing a mirage, then a smoke, and then the flickering of a butter lamp, and then, I've missed one out, sparks like the bottom of a wok, and then an orange sky, a white sky. The sparks are after you've lost consciousness, orange sky, white sky, and then you go unconscious for the first time, but this is a considerable time after your heart has stopped. You'll know more about this than I do. And then you regain consciousness for the first time, and that's your chance to become a Buddha, if I'm right. So don't miss it, guys. It's very transient and very fleeting. So the idea that there were shapes and that they would be misty shapes comes really from the mental states of the dying. Now, you can argue that are these shapes in the mental states of those people who are watching the dying, or are they in fact physical forms? I can't answer this. They're seen by one or two people, which takes them out of the hallucinatory bracket. And they are described as wavy, like the lines on the road, which you see in a heat haze. Do you see? Exactly the same. The next one is like smoke. It came out, it's not solid, it's like a smoke which comes up. And the most solid one that I've heard, it was like a white form which left, and that was after somebody had been killed in a tree cutting accident. So they're there, and they vary in substance. So that was that one. What was your second question?
Hellish realm being described in the near-death experiences.
The what?
The accounts of unpleasant spaces being visited during the near-death experiences.
Hellish. Isn't that interesting? I would love from that, totally. Now, I'm not going to answer you, clearly, that's what I was saying. Isn't that fascinating, what perception does? No. The way that I formulate this is that we have not had any stories of hellish experiences. We've not had any in our questionnaire. There have been no negative experiences of the hellish type. But let me be clear. That is that some people certainly have spiritual anxiety when they die, and always it's been related to unfinished business, usually with close relatives or wives or husbands. They get a very unpleasant death because there's all this attachment and they can't give it up. But beyond that, no, nothing. Are people afraid of their deathbed visitors? Only one or two mention any fear. But remember what I'm doing. That is, first of all, I'm taking stories of carers, because I can't ask them dying, because the ethics wouldn't allow it. They probably would now, because there's much more data on this. If your mum said that she'd seen a devil with a pitchfork about to plunge it into her, she died, would you really write and tell me that? Mm-hmm. So there's data selection there. But talking to hospice carers and so on, no, it isn't hellish at all. The picture that I've given you of the other realm, I think, is correct. David.
Thank you for a wonderful talk, Peter. I had one comment, but then I realised I had a better one, so I'm going to be cheeky and give two comments. And the first comment is a little bit frivolous, but it ties into a brilliant point you made about conscious dying and that, you know, you should refuse anybody comes along with any drugs. But a couple of years ago, Hameroff and Chopra put forward a kind of quite a controversial idea that actually buying into this idea of ketamine perhaps mimicking near-death experiences and preventing brain death, they suggested that people should be injected with ketamine as they're dying, and people are terminally ill, so they could prolong the state of consciousness and prevent cell death. Anyway, that's quite a rather controversial comment. The other comment was that, have you had any thought as to why people in these death states or near-death states have a lot of parapsychological phenomena? And if I could make a suggestion, there's an interesting paper put forward by David Rousseau, and he took a kind of systems approach to it and said, why do people have these so many psi and parapsychological experiences in these kind of dissociated states, or perhaps when they're least attached to their body, you know, out-of-body experiences, near-death experiences? And he said, well, maybe psi is in some way involved in the mind-body connection. And when that connection is broken, it frees up all that kind of resource for parapsychological.
I like that story very much indeed. I think it's right. Aldous Huxley, of course, is what immediately comes to mind. Should we all be injecting ourselves with LSD? Have I got an LSD ample? I get my wife to inject. No, I'm not familiar enough with it. I think I'll take the ordinary disintegration of consciousness. But it's a wonderful field for research. Be great if they would allow it. But they won't, of course. Incidentally, when I said don't take any drugs, you're allowed painkillers. Max.
My question has to do with what persists. Now, you've given us accounts of experiences of being visited by relatives and so on, loved ones, and no doubt those accounts are veridical accounts of what people experience. And then, for instance, earlier in the workshop, unfortunately, you weren't here, we had an account of what persists coming from Buddhist tradition. Which was unpacked in the term bhavanga, which my understanding anyway is unconscious tendencies of certain sorts, but certainly have nothing to do with self in the normal sense. So in fact it's quite difficult within Buddhism to kind of square the self, no self issue on this question, what persists. Now, we have very contrasting pictures here on that issue. And I want to place it in the center of something that, first of all, you know, I'd be interested in your views about. But maybe others would like to also after Peter has made some comment about that.
All I can say, I wasn't here and I don't understand the concept fully, is that they're not hallucinations. And why do I say that? Because other people see them. We've got 5% of accounts where the carers have seen them and children see them, and occasionally relatives see them. So relatives are the lowest ones, but carers and children see them, so they're not hallucinations. So you have to think of another model to take them in, apart from just being the hallucinations of the dying. But we'll come to that, because I'm sure that Alan will talk about that. Okay, you were next.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes. So my concern is that about consciousness, you have said that it's often said, actually, that we need to know whether it will persist after the death of the body. But that means that somehow we believe that consciousness, that for consciousness, time is relevant, and the categories of space and time are relevant. Now, what are space and time, after all, in our present experience? Space and time are essentially coordinates we ascribe to events that are experienced, and that by this method we can discriminate them from one another. Now, what about this basis of any coordination, which is conscious experience? Is space and time relevant? Are space and time relevant for this background of any coordination? I'm thinking of what a French philosopher of Russian origin, Vladimir Yankelevich, was saying about death. He said, death is the encounter of time and non-time. It's not, you know, it's not another time, it's not a continuation of something in time, it's just disappearance of time. And the same, I think, for what you presented about physics. The fifth and 11th dimensions are concepts that we use in our present living experience in order to coordinate observable events. It looks like, for understanding consciousness itself, we no longer need all these concepts. Consciousness is beyond these concepts, just as it is beyond time, space, and so on. So this is...
I like that very much. Yeah. And I like it from point of view of the near-death experience, where people go into the transcendent reality. Time is not important there. It's important in some parts of it, when you get a life review. Then time comes in, but most of the other times, time isn't there. Sometimes it's expanded into eternity while they're there. Other times it's much shorter. So time is very relative there. So I like the idea of it being very fluid. And I also like the idea that you go at death into a place where you lose time and you lose space, because it does actually seem like that. And certainly in the near-death experience, it seems like that. But then you have to ask the question, why do we in our culture always go into the same sort of reality? I mean, if I was a hunter-gatherer, in my near-death experience, I get into a canoe, paddle for 3 days till I came to an island. The island would be very much like the gong which we get to. And then he doesn't ever paddle back again, then he comes back into his body. But I mean, you know, they're obviously enormous cultural things as well as something which is belied. Alan.
I can respond to that, but I'd like to ask a question first, if I may. Very simple one. And that is, these were all Europeans, Irish, Dutch, British, as I recall. What about doing the same studies with very traditional Chinese, there are a few left, and people from different cultures? And see, that was kind of a very basic kind of research that needs to be done, to see how cultural this is.
Absolutely huge. I mean, the research is huge. I tried to set up a near-death experience study in the cardiac unit in Tehran, because I thought we'd get some really nice ones there. And the answer to that was,
they had only in 1 year coming out of Tehran Hospital, so please all remember this, only one person with a cardiac arrest survived. So it means that you've got to have a very high level of medical care before you start getting these experiences. But I've talked to a number of Muslim people who have given me data about what they experience when they die, and they're very similar in many ways.
Shall I respond to that in terms of, this might be interesting, about the transcending time and so forth?
Yeah.
There is a lot of literature or experience, I think, behind the literature, that those stages of death that you narrated from the Dalai Lama's book, that it happens very often that one slips into, after seeing these various visions and so forth, you simply become unconscious for some time. But if one is already highly trained in samadhi, specifically, so shamatha or methods for developing samadhi, then the prognosis is very good for being able to pass through all of the states right to that blackout phase that the Dalai Lama refers to as common knowledge to Tibetan Buddhism, and actually enter into that lucidly. And it's very comparable to falling asleep, going into non-REM stage 4 dreamless sleep, and being lucid at the same time.
Yeah.
This is still in time. It's still, it's not transcending space and time.
Yes.
It's really, it really corresponds exactly to that second dimension of consciousness I spoke about yesterday. In fact, that's exactly what you've dissolved into, that substrate consciousness, and in the Theravada tradition, that's exactly where you arrive in the Bhavanga. So I've come to the conclusion that experientially, even though interpretations are somewhat different, conceptual frameworks, but the substrate consciousness, especially as described in Dzogchen, and the Bhavanga described in Theravada, are in fact referring to the same experience. But then the Dalai Lama spoke beyond that. So what happens after this blackout period, which is a matter of, could be minutes or could be as long as 6 hours or even up to 3 days, where you are dead, but that is still within time, but just in this primal flow of the substrate consciousness. Then comes what the Dalai Lama referred to, but you didn't call it by name, it's clear light of death. The clear light of death, and this is where you are utterly transcending space and time. Inconceivable, totally off the charts. And if one is, if already had some experience of that, by whatever practice of meditation, the light of Vedanta, Vajrayana, Dzogchen, what have you, if you've already had a taste of that, then the metaphor is quite lovely. It said like a child crawling onto the lap of its mother. It's the mother clear light, is the clear light, that dimension of consciousness that is always present, and but you've had some glimmerings of it. And now that everything is dissolved into that, even the substrate consciousness is dissolved into this primordial consciousness, or this clear light of death, then there's a sense of familiarity that I've encountered this before. And it's those yogis, and we see it about every year or so, we get another account from Tibetans who they will die, all metabolic processes stop. Richard David has now studied one case of this, where all metabolic signs have stopped, but the body is not decomposing. And it goes on for days, sometimes with warmth of the heart. I actually witnessed this myself with Francisco Varela and Richard David. No, Richard David wasn't there. But Francisco Varela, Cliff Sarin, and so forth. And that, if you've already recognized that dimension of consciousness through your meditative experience, or for whatever way, then you have the real chance of lingering there. And this is where we have these yogis spending a week, 2-3 weeks, where the body remains all the freshness, the skin is clear and fresh, but there's just no metabolic signs and no EEG as far as we know. And then when that experience, that timeless experience finishes, then the body starts to decompose, right? But then what comes out, but that was slipping out of time, space and time. Now, the Tibetan account, difficult to scientifically check, is then space and time come back in again in a different type of bardo called the bardo of Dhammata, or ultimate reality. That's extremely archetypal, and then that's another opportunity for getting very deep realization. But if you slip through that, then you're in the ordinary bardo that Ian Stevens talks about, and his research Jim Tucker talk about as well, which came as something of a surprise to them. And that is, you know, and then we just think that's the bardo, and it's moving about. Basically, you're a ghost for a while until you're re-embodied once again. But there's only one interval that is absolutely transcending entirely space and time, and every conceptual framework, including that of existence and non-existence.
I think that's interesting. In fact, the only way that we can follow this is by asking people about the person who's died, and most of them are able to identify when the body is empty and when it's not empty. Mm-hmm. And it usually takes about 2 or 3 hours before the body's empty.
Well, one of the possibilities to interview children, as in Ian Stevenson, to recall having died recall what happened afterwards.
You could do it that way.
Being conceived, and those are random children, or the better yet is to have yogis, highly accomplished yogis, who pass through all of that consciously, and then they pop out the other side and tell you what it was like.
It's all possible. Just needs a lot of money. Yes, you were next.
It's a related question, because in Pondicherry, Sri Aurobindo, one of the yogis who did a lot of work on bringing in consciousness into the cells of his body. So this was consciousness as we define it in India, not just this, but the underlying substratum of everything. So when he passed away, one is his clock stopped at 1:26 at a.m. at night, early morning. And then his body had a whole glow about it for 4 days. So because it was in French territory at that time, this is in 1950, it was in French territory, the doctor used to come and check that the body is, you know, decomposing or not, because it was not against the law to keep a dead body like that. So for at least 4 days, the body just stayed luminous. And then after that, when there were signs of decay, then the body was buried. And similarly with the mother, she passed away in 73. And the same thing, her another clock, not in her room, but in the school, the clock stopped. Same, around almost on 1:26, I think, or something like that, again at 26. And then her body also stayed for 3 days. But these were people who, their whole sadhana was bringing that consciousness into physical cells of the body. So it was a very conscious sadhana. So it follows on what you were saying.
Yes, I think that's fascinating. Toyed with the idea of putting a very sensitive photometer in the room of the people who are dying. But I think I'm against that, really, because I sort of feel it's an intrusion. No, it's not really. I don't know. I'm not sure that it'll be terribly useful. Okay, let's go 1, 2, 3, 4. So we take the four people here in the front. So one.
Well, the risk of bringing this back to the mundane. So how rigorously has it been demonstrated that there's a total of absence of electrical activity in the arrest? And then
in cardiac arrest.
During arrest.
Yeah.
And then related to that, I know that there were at least proposed some prospective studies of out-of-body experiences in which photographs or some viewable objects were being mounted above the surgery table that could only be viewed from above. And I wonder if you can tell me anything about
it. Yeah. The first question is absolutely vital, because what I have done in this talk is assume that the brain, when the heart stops, becomes electrically silent. And I know you lose consciousness, but what are the physical factors which go with it? And the answer is something like this. Now, it started off with the tying of the carotid arteries in dogs, and they had electrodes in the cortex. They measured the EEG on the scalp, and they had depth electrodes. And what they showed was that when the blood flow to the brain stopped, not only did you get electrical silence on the cortex, but you got it in the depth as well. And so it has grown up with us that in fact you have electrical silence in the depth and on the cortex. Now, there is nothing that I know of which argues against that. There's been a recent paper on waves which occur in the dying brain. Actually, there are two sets of waves, but the first set occurs after the brain has been electrically silent for some time. But remember that if you're going to structure consciousness, the odd wave won't do it. It's got to be a highly coordinated series of events before consciousness can arise. So the fact that people are saying, okay, well, they maybe get occasional delta waves isn't going to give them consciousness. And to support that, you can look at things like barbiturate poisoning. And there you get something called burst suppression. You get long periods of nothing, and then you get a few delta waves, and then another long period of nothing. Now, these guys are not conscious, they're all absolutely out. So a few delta waves isn't, in fact, going to cause the presence of consciousness. The second one is the rat experiment. God, how these things get into the literature. In fact, it was done in humans. What they showed was that, and actually it's really interesting, but not interesting for us or for me, because about 10 to 15 minutes after you die, if you have a particular type of monitor on, which is called the bispectrum analyzer, you can measure activity in the brain. Now, this hasn't gone far enough, although people are beginning to do more research work on it. And there's no reason why you shouldn't monitor activity, because the whole brain at that point is, you know, broken completely. And so it's not an organized electrical activity, it's much more random than that. But because of the time after you've died, this is just the time when people are going to wheel you to have your organs taken out. And so the question now is for the implant people, are they brain dead if they're going to show electrical activity in the brain afterwards, where it's never associated with consciousness? But it does mean that if you're going to have your organs taken out, just write a caveat, please anaesthetize me, in case there is this electrical activity is associated with consciousness, which I don't think it is, in fact. So the guy who wrote that paper said, this is a model for the near-death experience. It got into the literature, it was a nice mechanical model, and everybody says now this is the near-death experience. Of course, there's nothing like it at all. So I think, yes, we can. The latest research on terms of oxygen levels as you become unconscious is that, yes, you can get oxygen coming up to the brain with chest compression, but the blood pressure will only go up to about 40, and that's not enough to get the circulation going. And after you have, in fact, had a period of anoxia, then the brain is starting to change its dynamics, and getting blood in is actually very difficult. So it doesn't really work.
In prospective studies of out-of-body experiences?
Yeah, there have been a number of those. None of them have succeeded. The one I've given you is in my view, the best one that there is. And they're very difficult to do, because if you know the person's going unconscious, he's usually in a cath lab. And what they do is they implant a ventricular stimulating pacemaker. And so they stop the heart and then wait for the pacemaker to start it. Well, you've only got a little bit of unconsciousness like that, and on the whole, that's not enough. And so, no, they're never seen.
So if I may add just to that, Bruce Grayson in Varieties has a review in which he discusses the anecdotal evidence for and the Samparni and other studies. And one of the problems has been that they have usually not had near-death experiences. They haven't partly found it because they were expecting that they would get a number of near-death experiences regardless of having possible sight or not, but they have gotten very few. But you can check if Holland and Grayson have reviewed that.
Yeah, they're very rare, actually, out-of-body experiences when you're looking for them. They're about 30% when you're not looking for them, so you don't get them in the right place, yeah.
Well, this is kind of a random thought, but any work done on stuff, I'm reminded of this because when you do judo, traditionally, when you get a black belt, part of the ceremony is you let the person put a choke and it cuts off the blood flow to the carotids and you're out. Now this happens a lot in judo practice. And I wonder if what's going on in the brain, it just takes about, once you cut the blood flow entirely, even 3, 4, 5 seconds, that's enough and the person's out. So one day a friend of mine and I want to see what that was like, you know, because no one had ever put me out entirely. You're going out, you know, you're going out and you do stuff to keep going, you get a little another pulse of blood or you tap out or whatever. So my friend did. And he choked me out, and I'm lying on the ground. And it was very interesting what happened. I saw a transcendent as nothing but this ego, just the perspective. And everything is perfectly clear visually, but it's all in black and white. There's no color. And I was going down along the spine. I never imagined this. And I'm going down along the spine, and I get down to around here, and then the knees are coming up in that, you know, reflex thing. And so then my friend lets up. And I said, why'd you stop? And he said, you were out. But so far as I was concerned, I wasn't out at all. I wanted to know what was going to go happen next. So that's what I was thinking. So my question is, what in terms of what happens to the brain when it has no significant amount of blood going in there, no oxygen, and supposedly non-damaging to the brain. You come out and you're happy and it's all cool. But what's going on in your, from your perspective, in the brain when that happens, and in what ways is that likely to be somewhat akin and not akin to what's happening in a dying brain? And was this the same kind of sort of experience? I mean, it was just silent, like you're deep in meditation. And
It's a brilliant question, and there is, in fact, a paper published.
Can you talk a little louder? My hearing aid went out.
It's a brilliant question. And there is a paper published in Germany. They started it when they asked people what their experiences were after they fainted. And it's given rise to a whole new theory of near-death experiences. And what that paper showed is that there is a varying range of experiences that people have, but amongst those are some with a sort of transcendent feel to them. And so they argue, well, the near-death experience therefore occurs as you recover, not during the period of unconsciousness. And the arguments about those studies are that, first of all, you don't get proper near-death experiences. You get flavors, but not proper near-death experiences.
You don't get what? Say it again.
You don't get near-death experiences.
Yeah, just some flavors.
But you get the flavor of it. And the other thing is that the period of unconsciousness is very short. So if the model which we have is correct, the transmission model, then if you knock out the consciousness system, it's not surprising that you should see a bit of transcendence of some sort coming through. So it fits nicely into that. But they argue this is the whole mechanism of near-death experiences, just in the recovery, because they've got to take it out of unconsciousness. So you put it into just that moment of recovery. Now, that would be fine. But we have a lot of accounts of people with deep near-death experiences that have a very prolonged recovery, and it's confusional, etc., etc. So it doesn't actually work.
And this, I don't think, was recovery, because I'm watching the process.
Exactly, exactly. Your consciousness is there.
Into it.
So. Yep. Yep. Yeah, it's a point against it. Who is it next? You, and then there's another one, Ravi. And then you guys.
I had a question. You mentioned in passing now life review, but I don't think you said much about that.
Nothing.
So I'm a little bit interested in that because of some Buddhist accounts of the dying process. So for example, I mean, one account says that, you know, that this kind of life review happens and some significant action that you have done, it could be one single action, comes before the mind that you may have done long ago but has a very strong resonance, and so it comes before the mind at the time of death. Or it may be some habitual action, or it can be some action that you've done very recently. I just wondered if you could say anything more about what the evidence is for this kind of, or are there stories about life review and so forth?
The life review I find very interesting. And I find it interesting in the near-death experience people I've talked to about the life review. Sometimes they will say, I had this fantastic life review, but when you question them on it, no, it wasn't. It's rather like you were saying, it's just specific things which have come up. Other people have a panoramic life review, and they really do. And as soon as you get that sort of experience,
it raises questions about the nature of memory and whether memory is in fact all in the brain or whether in fact you have to think in terms of external storage of the memory in some sort of way, particularly of course in the near-death experience when we're arguing there isn't proper brain function anyway. But I haven't seen a full analysis done of the cardiac arrest NDE life reviews, and that would be where we could start actually to understand these more. So I don't think the data's all there yet. Ravi.
Yeah, my question is related with some of the things that have already been asked or said, but has there been some data about the, if you like, the levels of consciousness of a person who is dying or has supposedly died? For example, if Raman Maharishi, if we had a data about him, it's likely to be quite different from somebody who has never had any sort of a spiritual training or experience or anything. So is there some data about it?
Very little. It moves one on to a thing which an area I didn't talk about at all, and that is, in fact, sudden recovery of consciousness from coma. And this occurs, I think one figure I saw from a New Zealand hospice is in about 6%. And there's a very nice paper by Bruce Grayson and Nam on the subject. It used to be called Lightening Up Before Death in the Victorian literature. And what happens is the person is deeply comatose and then he suddenly alerts. The other point is that when they alert, it's usually just before death. It's called terminal lucidity. And so what happens is you go unconscious, and then you alert, greet your relatives living, greet your relatives dead, then fall back and die. Well, that's interesting enough, but there are much, much more interest to it, and that is that we've got accounts from people in nursing homes when the dying have had profound Alzheimer's and haven't recognized their family, and yet when they come out of a lucid interval and they come back again, they in fact recognize the family. And so the other thing that they do is their bodies are totally paralyzed from strokes, but yet they sit up and hold out hands which they haven't used before. So there are a lot of interesting scientific things about that. But as to measuring the actual level, no, we haven't really got far enough with that yet. But Ravi, what I would like from you are a whole lot of high practitioners who are happy for us to examine them when they die, and from you, Alan, too. Okay, I'm coming to you in just a moment because I missed you out. You're okay.
My observations are triggered by your what you said about unfinished business.
Yeah.
A concrete example, a very close friend of mine died of leukemia. And when the doctors had given up and he was in palliative care, he sent me a word to come and see. I had known him for a long, long time. He was a very accomplished man in computers, a musicologist and a musician. And I was very close to the development of so many of his projects. And he started crying when he called me. It was about 3 or 4 days before he died. So I said, you know, what's the matter? Why are you crying? He said, I'm not afraid of death, but exactly what bothers him is unfinished business.
Yeah.
Okay, and I'm trying to make sense of what that means. And I fall back to my understanding of the life cycle in light of Professor Erickson's 8-stage model. What he says that the last stage of life has, in his view, looks at integrity versus despair. What he means by integrity is that a person feels integral in case he or she thinks that life is fulfilling because she or he has done things that should have been done. But if they are not done, then life is unfinished business, which is equivalent to producing despair. Okay. Now, there is a different cultures, these issues are dealt with differently. Part way in which understanding in cultures of death and after death care and so on is reflected in terms of rituals that have been there across cultures. There's a lot of literature in anthropology on rituals and death rituals. I made some serious study of that over the last several years. One instance of how people deal with unfinished business is a ritual in the culture I grew up in, where after death, within 10 days after death of 13 different regions, it's 12, 13, 14, whatever, and people who are close to the dead person get together and they leave some rice, cooked rice, usually on the riverside kind of places. And a crow is supposed to come and touch and eat if the life is not finished, there is no unfinished business. And the crow doesn't come and, it's probably totally accidental that the crow might come and eat or not. What happens, interestingly, that other people are supposed to say, what is it that the unfinished business of the person that you can help with? Whether it is settling a debt or whether it is getting his daughter married. And so people will very gladly say later that as soon as I said that I will get your daughter married, the crow touched. This might as well be a therapeutic device or a sociological device to help unfinished business to be completed by others. Okay, but the point is that the assessment of life toward the end of life, about fulfillment or otherwise, is an important issue in terms of how one feels in dealing with that.
Yes, yes. I liked that story very much, and I liked it for two reasons. The first one is how one comes to terms with unfinished business and how the relatives do, and I think that's important. But the other thing is this question of birds. You chose a crow to come and eat the rice. Now, we have so many bird stories, and they usually are birds sitting on the hospice window. The next set of stories goes to, out of the corner of my eye in the room, this is the dying people, I can see a bird and they will take my soul when I die. And then there are the post-death stories where the crow comes. Actually, they're usually a bird that the person likes. And they somehow or other appear in the home. Sometimes they come down the chimney, sometimes they come in through an open window, and the other animals behave in a very strange way to them. They're not chased by the cat, and the dog doesn't bark at them. It's as if they are, in fact, familiar in some way. And then they usually come, and when the person who's been bereaved comes into the room, they know that the bird is carrying the soul of the person who's just died. Then the bird will, in fact, go out. The lovely one the other day of a friend in Massachusetts. Their husband died, and a big snowy owl came and sat on the trees, and for the whole time until the funeral, just sat there and watched, and you got all these twitchers from all over Massachusetts coming and looking at this owl. But as soon as the funeral had gone, then the owl went. Fascinating.
There's a lot of literature on the concepts of people. This goes back to 1,000 years. I mean, at least some of it. As to what is it that the soul does after death? It's supposed to stay similar to the concept of being in limbo. The assumption has been for a long time that for about 13, 14 days, the soul hovers around in a matter of journey further to go. And then people deal with that, that is, unfinished businesses have to be taken care of. In the days of mourning, which is about 13, 14 days, after which there is a feast and there is finished business.
It's interesting, yes, they're all the same sort of stories, aren't they? Okay, time for one more question.
Okay, I was just going to say Celtic mythology, the crow tapping on the window. go is a harbinger of death.
Oh, that's right. Yes, we've got some lovely stories of flocks of crows over houses where people are going to die.
I just want to say one thing, that there's a whole tradition of the subtle body that goes right back to Egypt, and somebody called G.R.S. Mead wrote a book about it at the beginning of the last century. And it's something that really we perhaps should have brought up into conversation before, but the soul survives in the form of a subtle body. We actually carry the subtle body with us all the time when we die. What leaves is the subtle body.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and it seems very much like that.
And then it becomes the arc later on. It becomes the luminous light body later on.
Yes, this whole question of the light body and how you structure it and so on, I think is enormously important.
Also, I mentioned Elizabeth Kubler-Ross because she did an enormous amount of research, which I put into my book, but you must know about it.
What, the question of the light body, do you mean?
No, the whole thing of what happens at death.
At death, oh yes, yes, yes. Yes.
Gathered a huge amount of material. Anyway,
yes.
Thank you so much, I thought that was fascinating.
And David, you see, with his psychedelic drugs, or anybody who's dealing in psychedelics, the two merge very closely, and of course yours merges very closely too. So let me thank you all for listening, and none of you went to sleep, which is really brilliant. And let me thank Max very much for inviting me.